Hello, welcome to Real Stories, the lives of your favourite pop icons told through the stories of people that have known them, loved them, and done the rumpy bumpy with their mums. Today it's the not-so-feminine Eminem, Abba Butchers.
Drugs, the alcohol, the groupies, you name it, he pretty much did it.
Hi, my name is... He was Spider-Man, he'd fly around the house all the time.
You're pardoned for being white. You're that amazing.
Yo, this white boy is dope. Please stand up. Please stand up.
Please stand up. I'm glad I inspired you, but then why are you so mad?
Kim was kind of his sister there for a minute. You know what I mean? It was just so weird.
That was a statement right there. Like, if you don't believe now, kiss my ass. Just gonna
stand there. She smashed his head into the mirror on a tour bus.
You almost wish you could do the 8 Mile part two.
Yes, over the next 60 minutes, we'll be getting all the juice on one of the darkest, most controversial and hilarious artists in music history, as well as some funny pictures of a 5-year-old Eminem that we can all giggle at. We'll also be hearing from my two regular studio experts. Joining me in the cath from the Sun's Bazaar column, Mr. Gordon Smart. Hello, Gordon.
Good morning, Dave Berry.
Now, when you were 5, they must have called you Farty Smarty, Smarty Farty.
Did we go to school together? Smarty Pants.
I started that, yeah.
And, of course, from Moore Magazine, the one, the only, the lovely Abby Pethless. Hello,
hello,
Abby.
Hi.
And what was your nickname at school?
Just Shorty. I was really small.
You were really small.
Yeah, I still
you were. Let's put that in the past tense, shall we, Abby, who is still sat on a giant cushion. Right, before we start, I have to warn you, Eminem's life story makes an episode of EastEnders look like In the Night Garden. Gordon, Abby, I've bought some comfort blankets for you both. There's yours, Abby. Gordon.
Thanks, Steve.
There's yours. And I've got Boo Boo here. He's going to keep me chipper. I want to go through some dark times, peeps, but if we stick together, we can get through this, OK? But first, time for some pictures of the man as a wee nipper. Yes, it's the real Slim Baby.
Marshall Bruce Mathers III, born 17th October 1972 in St. Joseph, Missouri. Parents, Debbie and Marshall Jr. Abandoned by his father, Marshall and his mother spent years moving around the Detroit area, changing home and school every few months, meaning young Marshall never had time to make any real friends. No wonder with that, Barnett. Retreating into his own world, he would immerse himself in comic books and was rarely seen not wearing his beloved Batman or Spider-Man outfits.
He was Spider-Man, Halloween, 1978. He had the cape on and it was just like when you look at him in the videos now when he's playing a superhero. And he was Spider-Man, he'd fly around the house all the time.
Little did young Marshall know that a chance meeting with a packet of chocolate would shape the rest of his life.
He was eating his M&Ms one day and he was in the back of my car. And he would take the candy, and he was in the back seat, and he would put it in front of me, and he'd say, "What's that say?" And I said, "It's an M." So then he would eat it, and he'd put another one up there, and I'm driving down the street. "What's that one say?" And I go, "It's an M." And then, "What's that one say?" "It's an M." And he kept doing that, and I come, "Marshall, they're all M's. Just leave me alone. Eat your candies." He took the wrapper, and he stuck it in front of me. He goes, "Well, what's that say?" And I go, "It says M&M. Those are your initials." And he goes, "Huh." And the next day, we're in the store. He'd say, "Give me a bag of Mees." And I says, "A bag of what?" And he goes, "A bag of Mees. I'm Eminem."
His life would change forever when his best friend and uncle, Ronnie, played him a hip-hop track, and young Marshall got hooked on rapping and breakdancing, even performing in the street while he made his mum wear a cardboard sign saying, "25 cents to watch. Bargain." He even brought his newfound love into the classroom.
The students would have to put away their squares and their rulers and pencils and clean up, and we'd take off like 3 or 4 minutes and... occasionally, he and his friends would start exchanging like the rap where you just do the impromptu stuff. And don't ask me what they were saying because I pretty much ignored it.
But as a young white kid in the rough part of Detroit, he was never exactly going to make a career out of it, was he?
How proud is Don of that car? That is probably the most American thing I've seen since I showered with an entire baseball team and used apple pie shampoo. Abby, we know that Marshall didn't have the most privileges of upbringings, to put it mildly, but we also discover here that he was also a very lonely child. Do you think that attributed to the desire he has to be successful in later life?
Yeah, well, just being from a bad area gives you that drive and that focus to get out of it because there's no one there to help you, you know, no uncle who works at a record company or anything like that. So to get through it, you have to do it yourself.
Yeah, as we're going to see later on in the show as well, Marshall doesn't have the best relationship with his mother, but as we've just seen, he hung a cardboard sign around the neck with a bit of string. Have more respect for your mother, young man. Gordon, do you think that seeing these kind of non-privileged backgrounds, it's a bit of a theme, isn't it, with people that have become successful, particularly in the world of music?
Yeah, without a doubt, there's a very long roll call of rappers, for example, who have had difficult circumstances and gone on to be hugely successful. I mean, 50 Cent, when he was 12 years old, his mum was murdered, he went on to be a drug dealer. Jay-Z, I mean, in 1982, shot his brother. And it's not just them, I mean, there's a long list of rappers. But even over here, you know, you think about Professor Green, difficult upbringing, gone on to be very successful in rock and roll. You've got Noel and Liam Gallagher, came from a broken home. Amy Winehouse, Adele, the list goes on and on.
So if the kids at home have got a cushy lifestyle at the moment, they're not going to amount to anything?
Like you and me.
Exactly right. Okay, well, time to go back to Detroit, where a teenage marshal is told that white men can't rap. He'd obviously never heard Gordon. They don't call him the Beige Thunder for nothing. After flunking ninth grade three times, Marshall told his teacher he was dropping out of school, age 17, to concentrate on his music.
Marshall said, when you're 25, what do you want to do? And a lot of times they say, I don't know, but he just kind of sat up and his eyes kind of got big and he said, I want to rap. I'm looking at him and I'm seeing this white kid at an all-white high school telling me he wants to rap. What I said was, well, go for it, but get your education, because you don't want to squash anybody's dreams. But as he's leaving, I'm thinking, you want to rap?
Using the name he'd picked up in Don's car years before, he starts rapping on the Detroit scene as M&M and works as a cook in a local restaurant as a way of paying the bills. Don't worry, we're assured he didn't spit in the burgers.
When Marshall was in the kitchen, we used to listen to his demo tapes. And Marshall would be listening to him while he was cooking. And one time he gave him to Louie. Louie's my boss. Louie listened and he said, I don't know, Marshall, I think you're going to be cooking for a long time.
After his girlfriend Kim falls pregnant, he really pushes on with his music, releasing an album called Infinite through a local record label. The album is, to put it politely, absolute pants, and nobody takes a white rapper seriously.
There were several things we were up against marketing Eminem with the Infinite record. First of all, I ran into numerous people who couldn't even read the word Eminem. I had people going, you know, I went to the record store and I looked and letter M and it wasn't there. You know what I mean? We had that. We had, oh, he's white.
The summer of 97 is a low point. He fights a lot, drinks a lot, and is robbed a lot.
His houses had been broken into just repeatedly. He had one crackhead in one of the neighborhoods that he lived in with Kim. And this crackhead just kept coming back and taking everything. I think it got down to, like, you know, fingers in the peanut butter kind of thing, kind of familiarity this person had. And he basically could never catch him. This just like, you know, it was like the Slim Shady of crackheads.
Struggling to support his new family and with little prospects, his depression culminates in a failed suicide attempt. The world nearly loses a musical genius before he's even begun. Just as well that I've got little boo-boo here. Pretty dark stuff. A tough time in Eminem's life.
It's like a really bad episode of Hollyoaks. And when he has hit rock bottom, he even had to break into his own house to sleep on the floor after he was evicted. I mean, he's got nothing.
And speaking of which, Gordon, I'd be interested in your opinion. You know, a lot of people, if they want to get into a certain field and do a certain something, there's normally somebody they can look at or aspire to be. Was there any white rappers back in the day for Eminem to want to be?
They were few and far between. Not a great deal of inspiration there. I mean, Vanilla Ice.
Okay, well, let's move on.
But then, again, the Beastie Boys were the other band that were kicking around at that time, but the Beastie Boys were clowns of hip-hop.
They were. They kind of did the comedy videos, which we see Eminem doing a little later, but that's it.
So he was first in the queue. He was the man that really broke the mold and became the first big white rapper.
Okay, let's get back to the action where the most fruitful poo of Eminem's life would turn everything around. Top five things I thought I'd never say out loud on the TV. Number three. I've been so many places, I've seen so many faces. Fellow Detroit rapper and close friend Proof decides to form the Detroit 12 and asks Eminem to join. The concept of D12 being that the six members would each create a dark half-alter ego so that the group could push new hardcore styles and black comedy. This proves to be one of the most important turning points in Eminem's career as he comes up with his greatest ever creation while sat on the loo. M says, I was sitting on the toilet and boom, the name hit me. So I wiped my and I got off the pot and called everyone I knew.
I introduced him to a buddy of mine at the time, Jeff Cooch, who we all called Shady because That was his favorite word to say whenever something uncool happened. And I'm certain it was after that introduction that he actually called me up one day and was like, I got a new name. It's Slim Shady. I liked it immediately. It sounded great. And I told him, yeah, run with it.
The alter ego allows him to push the boundaries, go even darker, and most importantly, gives him a unique voice. With his newfound confidence, he takes the local rap battle scene by storm.
I found out about Eminem from a friend of mine. He kept coming to me and he said, hey man, you gotta come to the hip hop shop. Man, it's this white guy, he's up there killing people. You know, I'm holding the phone, and I'm like, come on, man. I'm like, you know, a white guy? I'm like, nobody's white at the hip-hop shop. So finally, he dragged me out the house. I come up to the hip-hop shop. And it was the one day when M had his classic battle with La Peace. And M was just going through different rounds and different rounds and different rounds, slaughtering everybody. I'm standing to the side like, I'm still trying to say like, yeah, white boy, you know. But by the final round, I had to say, hey, this boy is good. And in the end, M ended it with a classic line. He said, now go tell your friends he got beat by a white boy. And the crowd just, ooh. Then I found myself put my hands up like, ooh, you know, like, oh, okay. Like, yo, this white boy is dope.
How much do we all love DJ Babe? You know, we actually recorded that interview in his mum's basement, which his friends have nicknamed The Dungeon. Four of our crew went in, only three came out.
Gordon, first of all, because there are so many names flying around at this stage in the man's career, who is Slim Shady? Who is Marshall Mathers? Who is Eminem?
Right, it takes some explanation this, right? Marshall's the kid from Detroit,
right?
The one that's had the difficult upbringing, the hard life. Now, Slim Shady is the cartoon character. He's kind of the vehicle for his darkest thoughts. And let's be honest, there are quite a few of those dark thoughts. So the cartoon-style character there. And then Eminem's the combination of the two that has this wisdom and this overlooking, sort of sensible view of it all.
Do you think it's a way of being able to experiment with different sides of the music that you want to make and almost be able to kind of get away with it if it goes wrong?
Yeah, it's a nice little thing.
You can go, like, well, I'm Eminem. You know, that was Slim Shady, so that's nothing to do with me.
It's like little boys blaming their bad hand for doing something naughty. I mean, like we said, he does have these dark thoughts and he does need to express them, and that's a huge part of his allure and his character.
Okay, so we've seen Eminem grow from a shaggy-haired Spider-Man to a potty-mouthed rap battler with a sociopathic alter ego. They grow up so fast nowadays. After the break, he meets a very helpful doctor, and Tim Westwood says this.
It was just a zoothie out there, like a zoo. It was so crazy, but a movie because it was something epic.
Oh, Tim, see you in a few minutes for more real stories.